All right, thank you all for coming to our panel this evening. Really excited to hear from all of these folks on this really interesting topic around multidimensional biomarkers and machine learning-based approaches to for precision medicine. I'm Dave Messina. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the Chief Operating Officer at Cofactor Genomics, where we do a lot of multidimensional modeling, particularly looking at immunotherapies. I'd like to introduce or have my panelists introduce themselves one by one, starting with Wendell here. Wendell, please.
Hi, I'm Wendell Jones. I'm a principal bioinformaticist at EA Genomics, which is part of Q-Squared Solutions. I've been working in genomics for 17 years. If I can put in one quick plug, I'm also president of the relatively new MAQC Society, which is the offspring of decade-plus work by the FDA and FDA-led consortiums. We have our annual meeting coming up in April. We specialize in talking about massive analysis of large data sets and quality control. And so be on the lookout for that announcement if you'd like to contribute, because I assume since you're in here, you're interested in analysis of large data sets. So.
Thanks, that sounds great. Thank you, Wendell. Yuri?
Hey, I'm Yuri Fesco. I am the Chief Clinical Officer for Oncology and Clinical Alliances at Quest Diagnostics, medical oncologist by training. Nice to be here.
I'm Bonnie Anderson. I'm the founder of Veracyte. I founded the company 11 years ago. And we have developed and commercialized three clinical assays on whole transcriptome and machine learning for aiding in the diagnosis of thyroid cancer, lung cancer, and idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis.
My name is Douglas Atkins. I'm a medical oncologist from Washington University St. Louis Cycle Cancer Center. My area of disease of interest is head and neck cancer, and I'm a clinical investigator interested in inhibitors of angiogenesis and CDK4/6 pathways and the interaction with immunotherapy.
Gabe Bienwalner. I'm Chief Medical Officer at Palmetto GBA, the Medical Director of the MolDX program, and there we set coverage and policy determinations for molecular testing for Medicare for 28 states. I also have a history in industry and academia working with large data sets. Actually, I was at Washington too, so you can talk about that. I actually really like the fact that we have this screen in front of us so I can remember who I am.
Okay, gotcha.
Doug, I think your mic might not be on. And folks, just to give you a little organizational note, we're going to be talking about some questions to begin with, but we will have plenty of time for your questions as well. We want this to be an open discussion with everybody on this great topic. So to kick it off, I'd like to ask the panel, you know, really, why are we here? How have single analyte biomarkers failed us? And what is a way to think about moving into the future? Whoever would like to start?
I guess I'll start. I'm at the end. I was actually listening to a talk, Dr. Shaw from MD Anderson, and clinical track was actually discussing some of the issues that, you know, we have this classic paradigm of one diagnostic marker for one disease. And you know, clinicians in general want, and everybody wants things to be as simple as possible. We want to act, we want to treat this patient, so we want to know what we need to get there. But the reality is cancer is a really complicated thing, and we try to oversimplify as much as possible, but it breaks down. And the reality is I'm a big proponent of Bayesian analysis, and when we know more information, we should using that information instead of pretending it doesn't exist.
I guess I'll ask. I would agree. I mean, when we would never go back to the days where you did a single assay for every chemistry marker of the day. We would never go back to doing a WBC count and then a hemoglobin separately because they were two different questions. And I would love to see the diagnostic piece advance to where we take advantage of the comprehensiveness of the data and be able to inform on things that are important for treatment decisions at the same time as diagnosis. And I think the tools exist to do that. It's just that everything is still being done in its vertical bucket, as opposed to us working broadly together to bring that together. That's my dream.
I would also agree. I think that there's a lack of standardization amongst pharma, IVD, lab, as to even standardization of what are the data targets, how will the clinical outcomes be fed back into making the predictive analytics better. It's very compartmentalized. And unfortunately, we don't have a good way of breaking down those barriers, I feel.
Right.
Yeah, and I would just add that, you know, in addition to the comprehensiveness of the data, what's driving this is also the complexity of the biology that we're trying to make judgments on. And, you know, related to, you know, single analyte versus multidimensional, how many of you bought a car in the last 20 years and you made your decision based on only one attribute, which is maybe the price? Okay, yeah, okay, that's... Now, you know, when I was a poor graduate student many years ago, I won't name the number of years, there may have been a thing at that point where, given the amount of money I had, that was the sole determinant of how I purchased a car. But as we mature, as we gain, you know, whatever it is that we gain, obviously we go into that with a multidimensional approach, and there are, you know, different things that we're looking at that will guide us to the right decision related to what car we feel like is best for our needs. And it's not based on one thing. It's based on a whole multitude of different things. And thankfully, the industry is rich enough in order to offer that. But do we think biology, you know, cancer is any less complex than buying a car, for example?
I think that's a great way to put it, a great analogy. Doug, from a clinician's point of view, does that ring true?
Yeah, I would just emphasize that clinicians are hungry to have predictive biomarkers for their treatments. And when they're available, we utilize them greatly and depend upon them significantly. But we realize that for any one biomarker, there's a lot of error bar in its predictive abilities. So the need to integrate multiple biomarkers makes good sense to help make this a better world for, as a clinician, to select therapy and give patients some confidence that what we're gonna give them actually has a good chance of working, not just a chance of working.
And I think maybe to tag onto that, right? So we're talking, it seems like there's great consensus around the need for moving in a multidimensional direction. Maybe we could start by sharing some examples of successes in this area. You know, what are some good examples of whole genome or machine learning approaches that have delivered clinically valid solutions to patients?
I would say Oncotype DX is a very good example of one that required an incredible amount of effort, but has actually delivered the promise of not just we're going to give more treatment, but actually in some cases give less treatment because it is not beneficial to patients.
I can speak to one of our examples, especially given the last discussion that just took place around the NTRK drugs. So we built a thyroid cancer diagnostic test using machine learning. We enrolled thousands of patients into a clinical trial and followed those patients to get very pristine truth labels of diagnosis. And then we're able to use machine learning to classify them in a very complex sea of biology, because there's about 13 different subclasses of biology and thyroid conditions, into the buckets of diagnosis. And the classifier picks the features out of the whole transcriptome that gives that separation of the classes. And it's all been validated. We have now over 30 publications on this. But because the underlying assay runs on a whole transcriptome assay in our lab, we've also been able to build the pipelines for the data to pull out the rare RET variants, the NTRK fusions, both known and unknown fusion partners, all off the assay that's run at the same time the diagnosis has been done. So instead of sending 100 patients' tissues to be profiled to find two or three patients, you can actually pick those patients out of the data. And I think that's, you know, really powerful when we can advance that kind of comprehensive work.
I would say they're outside of common examples of multi-analyte, but still limited, like, for example, EGFR, L858R mutations plus T790M mutations, right? You're compounding biomarkers that are well characterized. There probably aren't too many successes, in part because we live in a world and a paradigm that's very much analyte specific. We live in a world where to match for clinical trials, you have to have the biomarker. And if you have four other biomarkers, you know, I working in, as the director of precision medicine program in a prior role, I would try to place patients, for example, on the MATCH trial. And they would have lots of potentially actionable mutations. But, you know, if you don't have the one that's for the one gene, for the one drug, then you don't match. Mm-hmm. And occasionally, you know, having run a large next-gen sequencing panel on many cases, we see very complex signatures. We see lung cancers that have not just EGFR mutations, but PIK3CA, known activating mutations in the same specimen, and cell cycle, you know, CDKN2A deletion. Mm-hmm. It's not unreasonable to assume that patient may not respond to the tyrosine kinase inhibitor, or if they do, it's going to be short-lived because there are already mechanisms to drive tumorigenesis that are already present that we're kind of ignoring. Mm-hmm. So I guess, you know, maybe it's clear what the implications can be.
It's complicated. Mm-hmm. Everything needs to be validated. There has to be clear utility.
So maybe we could talk about that a little bit. So, you know, we want to move away from a single analyte approach and ignoring some of the biology that we know is there. How do we start to get there? How do you start to think about addressing these problems? Is it with more data? How do you think about it, Wendell?
Yeah, so, yeah, obviously for measuring complex biology, you need to be thinking, you know, wider. And in fact, you're starting to see some assays now that are thinking beyond just measuring, for example, one type of nucleic acid, where now you have tests, you know, coming online like the TSO500, while primarily variant focus is also looking at fusions and things like that from RNA. And I think you'll start to see, again, a greater integration of multiple modalities, if you like. So it may not just be DNA, it may not just be RNA, it may include other factors. Obviously, you start from one sample, you may be able to isolate these different factors, and then if not offer one single test, there could be one test result that results from it, where you take the different analytes through whatever, you know, preparation they need in order to get one test result. But I think we're already starting to see examples of that, in addition to just, for example, looking at, you know, multiple or multidimensionality, for example, that RNA sequencing offers, and DNA does as well. DNA, we tend to focus on actionable stuff, which is relatively few. RNA seems to be a little bit more wide open in terms of how big the signatures can be to you know, address different complex biology. But certainly, I think, I think you've seen examples here, and you've heard discussions about what I hope to be is a wave of, for example, RNA-based biomarkers, which, you know, do have, I think, the promise of being able to be both multidimensional and classify complex biology related to efficacious treatment in multiple indications and multiple types of therapies related to that, whether it's targeted or immune-related or, you know, something else.
From a clinical perspective, maybe Yuri or Doug, how do you think about trying to integrate these new types of information into practice today?
I would comment that it seems like more often than not, the predictive assay development comes after knowing the results of the studies, which puts you behind because the field evolves subsequent. So I would suggest maybe trying to be more involved right when those randomized trials are being conducted. You have access to tissue, you have solid clinical data, you've got good tissue usually. It's a requirement to go on trials. And then, I mean, you have to partner with the person developing the drug, but but I think that's really where you'd want to be as you pursue the multiplex assays versus sort of being kind of behind, a little bit behind the eight ball all the time, you know, once things have become developed.
I would agree. I think the one thing that I think has in the clinic has become very complicated is immunotherapy. And the big thing that I see all the time now is immunotherapy moving further and further upstream to the beginnings of therapy, where we really are beginning, but we don't have great ways of predicting who's going to respond yet. And it very much calls into question, you know, we can say it's very easy to get another sample, but it's really not that easy to get another sample, and whether or not the assays that we do at the time of diagnosis continue to predict further down the line, whether or not things like, you know, ctDNA are going to be, or liquid biopsy is going to be the answer, or whether or not you see multiple clones. I think those are the questions that we're going to rapidly face, and we don't really have a good answer at this point.
I think we have to build very comprehensive clinical cohorts and have to have a mechanism of having patients enroll to follow the patients over time and be able to take the large-scale data that we can collect and go back to that data with new labels as they come in over time, and not have to rely on going and getting more pieces of tissue from the patient. So the more we can collect from a single small biopsy and then following patients over time and enrolling literally hundreds and thousands of patients into these clinical cohorts so that the conclusions we draw are more generalizable. It can't be done in small cohorts of patients that don't represent the world.
I would say from a payer perspective, I'm going to put on my Palmetto hat. We're doing things to help enable this. Obviously, our job at Palmetto, or the MACs, or the Medicare and other payers, is to pay for services that are reasonable and necessary, which can present kind of a conundrum. In the past, it often, if you had a complex test with a lot of analytes in it, there was a requirement to ensure that every single component in there met that bar, or none of it was covered, which I think we've changed our perspective on it now, so that we'll pay for the components that are reasonable and necessary. If you want to do other things on top of that, fine. You know, it's in there, okay, we're not going to stop you. We have policies to this effect now. We have a NGS, next-gen sequencing, solid tumor draft policy, which will go into production soon. It's near finalization, and also for myeloid malignancies. And now we've put out new draft policies that are going to go to open meeting, meaning that they'll be open for comment from providers on pharmacogenomics with similar kinds of language. Additionally, we're moving away from the analyte-specific world in the context of the policies as well, where we're trying to define the service not as a test of this many genes for these many indications, but a test of understanding the genomic landscape of a tumor, or a test that that helps explain the pathomechanisms of disease. For example, I think an analogy to that is, when you take a biopsy and you send it to your pathologist, you don't tell them, I only want to know if this is lung adenocarcinoma. Don't tell me anything else beyond that. No, you give it to them, you say, what's the diagnosis? And I think that's where maybe a lot of molecular diagnostics is heading, where you're going to send them the pathologist the specimen, and instead of asking, is there an EGFR mutation here, you're going to say, what's driving this cancer? You know, how can I target this cancer?
more focused on the answer rather than the method, maybe.
Yeah. Sure.
The answers.
The answer, right. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
I think I would add, you know, that there's been a lot of discussion about the application of these strategies to targeted therapies, but I would challenge the field to look at the large world out there, which includes, for example, adjuvant radiation is given to a tremendous amount of folks who, some of which benefit, but many don't. There are a lot of standard drugs. I mean, believe it or not, we still use cisplatin and we still use Taxol. Drugs I used when I was a fellow 30 years ago, we're still using them. And we probably will for a while. And so who benefits from that? We don't have an answer. We also don't have an answer on who gets toxicities. You know, if we had predictive assays that said you're going to get renal dysfunction from platinum, that would impact my treatment decision for you. So there's all kinds of things that maybe isn't being looked at yet, but opens up a lot of opportunity for the field.
So maybe some of these same tools can be applied not just to what we think of as new medications that are needing, but really some of the therapies that have long been with us.
Yeah,
I know that, you know, we've had experience working with different indications, including like autoimmune disorders. There are different therapies for autoimmune disorders. Not all of them are effective. Obviously, there are people that are concerned that we're spending a lot on therapies that don't benefit, you know, patients. So can we isolate easily those patients where a particular therapy for this autoimmune disorder, you know, is not effective? And to me, that's a great illustration of utilizing, you know, either single or multidimensional biomarkers to understand is this therapy going to be effective for this person? That's not cancer or something else, for example. You know, but something very prevalent.
We've all talked a lot about some of the promise of this, and it's clear to say that everyone's excited about, you know, kind of the potential and actual already benefits that we're seeing from these approaches. How do we make sure that we do it in a way that is well accepted? How do we do it in a way that's scientifically valid? I think, you know, there have been some stumbling blocks in the past that have made people gun shy with multi-analyte approaches. What are your thoughts on overcoming some of those objections?
Well, I think to Gabe's point earlier, it takes time, it takes a lot of capital, it takes collecting a lot of patient samples and a lot of clinical and phenotypic data on those samples. It takes the capital to run the assays that you're going to run, the bioinformatics and all of that work. And so while some would like to just take these assays and put them into a lab and begin to just start, you know, filling our MolDX posts and getting paid, the reality is, and maybe this is why there aren't a ton of great success stories yet, is because it takes time and it takes a lot of money to do it right. And when you do that, whether, you know, you're common on type DX is a great example, seeing Taylor X data come out 10 years later and say, look, here's an example of something that was right. You could trust these results. And there's other, you know, examples beyond that, but there aren't hundreds of them. Mm-hmm. There's a few.
I'd say part of it is also that, you know, we have the evidentiary bars that have been in place for 20, 30 years that may not apply. I think when we talk about NGS being a paradigm shift technology, I think the real paradigm shift is going to be how we apply it. Because if you think about the fact that it takes, you know, we talk about a complex system of multiple variables and assume that we need X number of samples to prove that anything is true, you're never going to satisfy those conditions. You're never going to have enough patients to satisfy the standard evidence-based approach that's sort of ingrained into most physicians' minds. And so we're going to maybe, the paradigm shift may actually be that we change our approach to the problem and come up with new ways to compile evidence.
I could go into more detail.
Yeah, I'd love to hear from more thinking about sort of new ways of approaching this problem. Anybody?
Well, I was just going to say one paradigm shift that I'm beginning to see that wasn't there several years ago. I mean, if you think about next-gen sequencing, it's been around for about a decade. In one sense, that seems like a long time. In another sense, you know, from a scientific history viewpoint, that's not very long at all. When you think about the acceleration in the advancements in technology and things like NGS over the last decade, one thing related to clinical diagnostic that's very, very important is consistency of the protocols. Mm-hmm. Okay. And if there's one thing that has not been consistent in the last decade with NGS technology, it's consistency of the protocol because the technology is advancing so rapidly. Now, that is starting to change, not in terms of the advancement of technology, but the technology vendors are starting to understand that they can't keep changing the recipe if they want to have clinical diagnostics. And so they're getting now to a point where they're able to say, okay, this is a protocol we're going to take down, you know, a GMP path and get, you know, particular instruments signed off. And you're getting more and more of that, you know, occurring. And that's an absolutely necessary step because there are many different assays, whether it's protein or RNA or some other assays, that are very sensitive to changes in protocol. And if that it occurs, then you can't have, to me, a useful clinical diagnostic long-term. So again, I'm glad to see that they're beginning now to devote resources to standardizing and fixing particular implementations so that we can, you know, what I hope is benefit from this multidimensional information they're providing so that we can, you know, get approval of these types of biomarkers and diagnostics with FDA approval.
So not all RNA-seq is created equal or the same. Certainly not all DNA-seq.
Change
the sample. Change the way the sample was collected and stored or preserved. Change the way it was extracted. All of those little steps that have nothing to do with the sequencing even make the results.
That's right. And nothing to do with even the preparation, right? So, I mean, we use at least five different RNA preparation protocols. And while each one is very consistent in itself, if you compare them in absolute terms, they provide different numbers. So I think that's one issue is that we say, you know, a term like RNA-seq, we assume that all RNA-seq is equal. That is not the case. If you run RNA-seq protocols today, you will not match numbers with TCGA because the TCGA protocol is a protocol that is no longer used or manufactured. Okay, so if you think you can compare absolutely to TCGA, I've got some news for you. So
I agree. Yeah, I think you know we tend to see these public databases as a purely benevolent resource, but we have to remember that there are caveats that come with it, and even within the TCGA, that not all the data was generated. I think using the same protocols. I think you know this ties back into to earlier comments about really just us being able to have better controls or protocols that are associated with developing these assays. We can perhaps be more cautious, I guess, if you will, given that we are generating so much more data with NGS-based techniques. It's easier to get good statistics, for example, when you've got millions of reads versus just a handful. And you've got consistency from a GMP point of view. Yuri, are you seeing calls for this in your world as well?
I am. I mean, I think the one thing that I would point out that I think as a nation or as a world we have to face is that a lot of this stuff is being developed again in silo, and it's being driven by, you know, this pharma company is developing this product, this one's developing that product. They take it to Q squared or whoever and sort of develop it in isolation and then try to generalize and take it globally, but they haven't talked to each other. And so the method that they used is not consistent. And I think as Palmetto, one of the things that would be very helpful is to sort of strive to be the bridging body to sort of say, listen, I get where you're going. Everybody's going to personalize medicine. But at the same time, we do need you guys to talk with each other because the classic example is PD-L1, where we ended up with just a complete fiasco. And I'm concerned that we seem to be headed there in some of the immunotherapy areas.
Well, and that was even with a single analyte.
Exactly, with a single analyte. Yeah. Can you imagine when we get five?
That was directed towards me. So towards standardization, so a couple comments, both pro and con. Pro, you know, we instituted technical assessments as a component for any NGS test, which wasn't there prior. Yeah. For that explicit reason, it works on multiple levels, but you know, to ensure that people have no idea what they're doing, mm-hmm. should not be doing this and to prevent them from doing it. But also to make sure that there is established criteria for a proper validation. It's one thing to validate a test, and then there's another thing to really validate a test clinically for clinical use. And so we're trying to ensure that with these processes. On the flip side, we also don't want to say, oh, we like this test. Yeah. Everyone's got to do this test. No. Because mm-hmm. the reality is, and you know, to even to the last this discussion point, when you're comparing two tests and they're discrepant, we see lots of papers that come out every now and then from Johns Hopkins for some reason, always comes from them. Oh, we took these two labs and we sent them these samples, the same samples. They came back with different results. Our conclusions is that all these tests are terrible. And the reality is that you know, there could be completely legitimate reasons that you have two different answers for two different tests, and there's actually nothing wrong with either. It's that they're not testing the same things. They have different, they're covering different genes, they're covering different sections of genes, they're covering different types of variants. And to tell the world that we're only going to cover you if you do the Illumina TrueSight 170 panel and everything else is garbage, then I think we're doing a disservice to the world. So I don't feel like that's our job, although, you know, I understand what the value would be. But what I would agree with is having additional studies that are that cross platforms to ensure that, you know, if I have this platform and this other platform, that the discrepancies are understood and there's cross-validation across platforms, and which is, of course, an acceptable way to do a validation against another lab test that's already been validated.
That's a great point.
Yeah.
I have a couple of points, and it sort of comes back to, I think, Bonnie and Wendell's comments about the methodology being consistent. You know, eventually you have to validate this in a clinical world, and you want to partner with people who have consistent, high quality data output too. That varies too across the world, and that's very important to ensure that you validate. You may have a great test, but if it isn't being tested, validated appropriately, it will become a negative test. And the other thing is, you know, I think that it might be worthy of the field trying to look at early surrogates of outcomes that we all want to see, survival benefit, right? But that takes a long time to, you know, Taylor X, all these studies take forever. So if you could look at and partner with whoever, FDA, to focus on early surrogates of what are known to be surrogates of outcomes that are of interest, you might be able to more rapidly conduct validated trials and get to your result that you want early versus waiting for these decade studies that slow the field down significantly.
I think one of the reasons that we've seen in this space the emergence of the single laboratory, almost a laboratory for every product, is out of the necessity for a lab to feel like they have to have the total control over the entire process from the time a sample is taken until they report patient results. Because in our world, we've seen the data where if you don't control all of that stuff, you end up with garbage. But I think that's because, well, quite frankly, we're still in infancy of having these advanced genomic types of tests. I think over the next decade, you know, we're going to see a lot of advancements where you can have more of these tests that do become more distributed and that, you know, other laboratories can take these assays and run them as well. But right now there's a lot of single labs to single products because it's the only way to control the quality of the data. And you have, you validate it, not only clinical validation, but the analytical validation work is hard to put into the hands of another lab and see it reproduced. It's just the infancy of the field, I think.
I think it's a good point to maybe engage the audience. Folks out there, you've been listening to all of us for about half an hour. Your comments and questions. And we've got a microphone going around. We are recording this. So if you'd please raise your hand for the mic.
Hi, thank you all very much. I'm Tasha Fingerlin from National Jewish Health in Denver. And I'm very interested in your thoughts on, and we've touched a little bit on it in terms of indications outside of oncology. And then also for academic institutions that have partnered somewhat with biotech, are thinking about spitting things out. How do you envision partnering early so that you're in that process early? And is that's one of the things that I wanted to also hear about was the broader role of multiplexing early on so that you can identify a lot of things and not be too narrow too early. And is that actually something that should be extended throughout the process so that when things don't go as expected, you have more data than you might have if you narrow too early? So perspectives on outside of oncology and then the role of multiplexing to allow you to be adaptable as you move on.
Our third test is in interstitial lung diseases. It was probably the toughest clinical challenge that we tackled. Interstitial lung diseases is probably the poster child for diagnostic uncertainty and lack of differentiation of disease from a diagnosis standpoint. And, you know, for if we were a drug company, this would be normal protocol. But as a diagnostic company, we literally started a 33 site, what became, you know, several hundred patient enrollment into a large scale trial in 2010. And wrapped that trial up, had the cohorts that could be randomized into a training set and or training set and test set for validation, and took 5 to 6 years to get that product to market. And then collecting the additional, you know, clinical utility data to get all of the data that you need to get a test like that covered. In diagnostics, it's almost hard. We don't make enough money on these tests to take 6 years to go from concept to revenue, but that's what it takes. And yeah, so that's an example outside of oncology where this can work.
Was it helpful to you to take a large approach? I think your other part of your question was around multi, taking a kind of widening the iris.
This was the indication that we started with the whole transcriptome sequencing. Mm-hmm. We knew that it was going to be a very tough clinical challenge, and we knew we had lots and lots of patients we had to enroll in the study, and that we had to have most of the subtypes of the diseases represented in numbers for the statistics to be able to work to find the patients ultimately with IPF versus the other 15 interstitial mm-hmm. lung diseases. So we started with the whole transcriptome and then just kept the assay on that. What's good about that now is with the assay running in the lab and patients enrolled in longer term follow-ups, then we can 3 years from now collect new labels for those patients and be able to go back to the same whole transcriptome data and bring new tests that answer different questions without starting the clinical trial over again. So I think if you have a long view, which we have always had in our clinical business, that you're going to start and build broad and go deep on the data, it can set you up for a lot of other clinical questions you can answer over time without having to start over.
Yeah, I'll just go quickly add one barrier to starting broad and then focusing in based upon your original results is sometimes we couldn't always translate results from a platform, let's say that was in like Bonnie was saying, whole transcriptome to a focused platform like PCR or nanostring or things like that. But I think we understand much better how these different assays relate to each other. And to me, it's not an issue anymore about translating information from one platform to another, so long as you run samples in both, okay? So in other words, I feel like I'm very confident talking to clients saying, hey, if you're in a new area of biology that has been characterized very well, feel free to start whole transcriptome in multiple different ways. And then as you determine subtypes or characterize whatever biology, possibly doing multi-analyte or multi-dimensional biomarkers, we can then confidently take that into something that's more focused, simply because we know about limit of detection now in all these platforms. We know more about signal compression or translation in these different platforms. So at least I think feel like now we have the experience that's able to convert information that you get in one modality into another, given our experience that we've had collectively in these different areas.
Hi, Federico Monson, Castle Biosciences. Wanted to follow up on two things that was talked about. I think going broad can be done, but it also depends on the disease and the specimen that you're looking at, right? So transcriptomics is really good when you're using fresh tissue, when you're talking about a fine needle biopsy from a thyroid or from lung. But it is not that easy when you're talking about paraffin-embedded tissue and that tissue that is degraded, where transcriptomics becomes, more of a nightmare than actually, good data. And I know Cofactor has been doing work on trying to get that to work, but I don't think we're there yet. And
we're there.
Becomes...
We are there.
Oh, good. So once we're there, it'll be great.
See how fast the field is moving?
Exactly. So that is a definite barrier. The other one I would want to touch base on is really... And one of the things that was discussed is about these large studies and the requirement for patients. Number one, Bunny already talked about the capital that we're required to do that. And, I think at Castle, we just went from startup to not a startup anymore. But, the amount of capital that has required to get there has been tremendous. And then how do we do that when we're starting to segment diseases, right? Or when we're starting to ask the question for smaller groups of patients, right? It's relatively straightforward, I would say. I don't say it's easy, but it's straightforward. How do I go about raising capital when my market cap is going to be, 60,000, 100,000, 200,000 patients, right? In many of the diseases. But when you start segmenting that and molecularly identify smaller groups of patients, or when you have a rare disorder, right? We have a test for uveal melanoma. And those are 1,600 patients a year. And it costs me the same amount of money to develop a test for those 1,600 patients than it takes me to develop for 100,000 patients, right? Yeah. So how are we going to achieve that once we start partitioning into, these molecular subgroups or tackling these rarer disorders? And it doesn't have to be 1,600 patients. And you can talk about, other disorders that it's 4,000 patients or 6,000 patients a year. And how do you tackle?
Well, unfortunately, costs have dramatically come down. When we started the company a decade ago, we couldn't have afforded to do the level of sequencing we're doing now, and now we're running every sample through the lab on whole transcriptome sequencing. So fortunately, costs have come down, but it's a challenge.
I don't think this will answer your question as satisfactory as you'd like, but I think it might help. I think there's a sense that the diagnosed or the predictive biomarker test is a one-time application on a patient. And maybe that's not the right strategy. For example, when we're looking at the evolution of the RNA transcriptome mm-hmm. under the influence of pembrolizumab before surgery, there's dynamic changes that occur mm-hmm. that have implications on not only response, but why it's not responding. Mm-hmm. And that's an example of sort of a dynamic effect. The other thing is when you're treating with patients with metastatic disease, that disease evolves. What starts at point A is not the same at point C. And it's a different biology. And I think that, you know, the field might want to be thinking about a dynamic process as opposed to a single application. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Single application sort of.
I'm sorry.
It helps us. But I mean, I think, you know, we've seen these publications in NEJM showing how five tumors in a patient, there may be four different biologies going on, and yet we aren't dealing with that.
So I will answer your question. So I'll say that, you know, from a, I think really the question is, why should I, how can I justify spending all this money, or do I have to spend all this money? Do I really need 1,000 patients when there's only 40 available every year? The answer is you don't really. And speaking from a payer perspective, right, there's we cover services that are reasonable and necessary. Now that can mean there's some objective criteria for a diagnostic test that we have to come by, but within every objective criteria, there's a lot of subjective room, which is why we have physicians performing the role as the medical administrative contractor, contracting medical director, we leverage our expertise and experience to decide whether the criteria are met. And I guess the point of that is it depends on a lot of factors, what you need to get to that level of meeting the criteria of reasonable and necessary. And in some diseases, that could be a very low bar. A good example is in liver and kidney grafts, where there's really not much of a standard for these procedures of how to follow up these patients or what if somebody's going through rejection or not. So you could come up with a test that has utility because the field is so immature that even if your test has 50% sensitivity, it's still better than the alternative, which is nothing. So getting coverage for something like that, you know, is easier.
However, I do want to make sure the audience is clear that MolDX is not national. And there are certain, depending on where your lab is, you may or may not be able to take advantage of the advances that they've made in creating pathways and standardized approaches for this. So kudos to you guys, but you know, it still is not a program that's available to every lab in every state in the country yet.
Well, when you go through the decision of how much you should spend for, you should consider moving to a state. We cover 28 states.
People who have done that.
Do you think there's an avenue to adapt some of these tests to a monitoring style approach? As Doug suggested, is the system set up for that kind of thing from a payer perspective?
I guess I'm not.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah. I mean, one example would be there a company called CDX that mm-hmm. has monitoring tools to monitor transplant patients, and your program was set up to, you know, cover that. So yeah, there are not too many examples, but there are examples.
Yeah, I was gonna say CML is pretty good. Yeah. You know, in terms of there's one where you do monitoring for years and you look for resistance patterns and.
But the question was whether we would cover a test that
does monitoring.
Provided that we find that the test has utility and, of course, analytical validity and clinical validity, and is a covered benefit, and is not contradicted by any language, any national policies, then absolutely we can cover a test like that. And you just mentioned a couple. And sometimes the definitions, even within the national policies, are broad enough that a local coverage determination can be used to clarify it. Mm-hmm. And that's happened, for example, in things like, what is a primary tumor? If the national policy says you can only do this test once in a primary tumor, but the definition of a primary tumor can change if the tumor is no longer and is defined as a lesion that no longer responds to a therapy. Now it's no longer the same tumor. Well, then now we could potentially cover it. So, you know, a lot of what we do is, you know, operate within the structures that are there, and you know, we try to make the best policies we can, knowing that there are limitations to what we can do, but there's enough gray zone that you can be fairly creative to get a good quality policy out there.
Other thoughts, questions from the audience? No? Any final thoughts from panelists?
Great discussion.
Well, I want to thank you all for a really great discussion. I really enjoyed listening to it. This is something I think that, you know, we're all seeing early promise on, and we have clear avenues to expanding this. I think that we got some really great different perspectives from different parts of the community here. And so I want to have everybody join me in thanking our panelists. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.